Today I will give demonstration. I will show you how to carve permanent mandibular first molar. For that carving you need one wax block, then one Lacron's carver, scale and gospels. First of all, to carve permanent mandibular first molar, first of all you have to make these all surfaces smooth, which is very important. Until and unless you don't make this surface smooth, you cannot carve properly. You cannot access each and every undercuts, and cannot remove undercuts and wax also, extra wax. And it becomes very easy to carve also by making the surfaces smooth. Now the first step is, this is base, so never carve for the base part because you may get porosity. So always carve on the other side, opposite to the base. So the height of crown is, you have to measure the height of crown, which is 6.5, and this is the smallest height, cervical occlusal height in dentition. So from the central incisor towards molar, if you go, then it is in decreasing order. So the smallest height, cervical occlusal height, you will find in all molars. So the cervical occlusal, this is the one of the class trait of molars, that their crown height is smaller, the smallest one. And the root is also small, root length is also, as compared to other teeth, it is shorter. So this is the, I will mark, this is the root length, and the base will be slightly larger in this tooth, as the crown is also smaller and shorter. Crown is also shorter and root is also shorter. Now name the surfaces. As this is mandibular first molar, mandibular teeth, they are wider mesiodistally. So you always see this block, at which side it is wider, and name accordingly. So now as these are wider mesiodistally like this, so I will mark this surface mesial, and opposite to this mesial, this is distal. So automatically remaining part will be buccal, and opposite to buccal, that is lingual. So you have to make crown mesiodistally wider. So first of all, from the crown you have to mark the outline. How is the outline? First of all, you have to carve mesial and distal surface, which is very important, because always in all teeth, mesial and distal profile is converging cervically. So you have to carve mesial and distal profile converging cervically. This is mesial side and this is distal side. So now this is the mesial and distal profile. It is mesial cervically converging. Now you have to make buccal surface. You have to carve buccal surface. Divide the crown into three equal parts. Now you should know where is the height of, where should be the height of control. For this you have to carve divide this crown into three equal parts. So this is occlusal third, this is middle third, and this is cervical third. Now as this is mandibular tooth, the crown appears to be tilted lingually. All mandibular teeth from premolar to molars, crown is tilted lingually, appears to be tilted lingually. And for that, the cervical, for that you'll have to carve cervical third area, there will be the presence of height of contour. So if you want to show height of contour over here, don't try to carve at the cervical third area. From middle to the occlusal third, you start carving and make surface smooth and slow. Now you can see, without touching cervical third area, I carved from the cervical third area, I carved occlusal, middle to occlusal third. And similarly on lingual side also I will mark the crown, and the crown is overall convex. So to make crown overall convex on the lingual side, you have to carve from the occlusal surface and slightly cervically. So automatically you will get overall convexity of this crown. So now you can see this is the overall convexity of the crown on the lingual side, and there is a height of contour present on the cervical third area, and there is the slope on the occlusal third area. So you can see this. This is the cervical third area, which is this is the height of contour and this is the slope. And now as crown is buccolingually narrower and mesiodistally wider, as well as you have to prepare the crown into, you have to divide, you have to carve 5 cusps on the occlusal surface. For that, before carving occlusal surface, we have to prepare buccal, lingual, mesial and distal surface. So how is the buccal surface? As I told you, cervical third area is the height of contour is present in the cervical third area, and the crown is sloped from the middle to occlusal third, and on the lingual side the overall convexity is present. Now on the mesial side the crown is converging lingually. The crown is slightly narrower on the lingual side, and the buccally the crown is wider. So you can see the convergence of mesial side towards lingually. Similarly on the other side, that is distal side also, the crown is narrow. Now the you have to carve buccal surface. How to carve buccal surface? Now divide the crown into, they are divided into 3 unequally. So the mesial surface, suppose this is mesial surface and this is distal surface. So mesiolingual, mesiobuccal cusp is wider. So mark this developmental groove on this side. So mark one groove over here and mark another groove more towards distal side. You can mark these 2 grooves on the buccal side so that you can make 3 cusps. So this is mesiobuccal developmental groove and this is distobuccal developmental groove. So this is now there are 3 cusps you can see. Mesiobuccal cusp, which is slightly wider, distobuccal cusp, which is less wider, and this is distal cusp, which is smallest one, which is most on the distalmost side. Now you can extend this distal, this is this developmental groove towards the center part. Similarly the another groove which is present, you can extend it toward the center part of the occlusal surface. Now at the same time on the lingual side also there are 2 cusps, there are 2 cusps. So you have to mark 1 developmental groove on the lingual side and divide the crown into 2 cusps. So now this is 1 cusp, 1 lingual cusp, mesiolingual cusp, distolingual cusp. Now on the occlusal surface you have to mark, there are 3 pits present on the occlusal surface. 1 is on mesial side, 1 is on distal side, and 1 is on the centrally placed. So there are 3 pits. This is mesial pit, distal pit and central pit. Now these 3 pits are present and it is just join it by marking a 1 single groove. Join them and this groove is called now central groove. The central groove runs from the distal cusp to the distal pit to mesial pit through central pit. Now you can see, you can see there are the total 5 cusps. Now you can see these grooves outlined where you have to, I have marked this 5 grooves 1, 2, 3, and this is central groove. Now, which will divide, if you carve it properly, you will make 5 cusps. So, to make 1 cusp on the mesial buccal side, you have to make V-shaped notch on the occlusal surface of mandibular first molar. You have to make this notch, centrally placed notch on the occlusal surface. Now you can see this notch. You can see this notch where this is buccal, entire buccal side, and this is lingual side. This notch will properly divide 5 cusps. So you have to make 5 cusps on the occlusal surface. By making this notch, now you can separate. This is mesiobuccal cusp, this is distobuccal cusp, and this is distalmost cusp. Similarly, on lingual side, this is mesiolingual cusp and distolingual cusp. You can see you have to make 3 cusps by marking 2 grooves over here. So these 2 developmental grooves we have marked, and we have carved 3 unequal cusps. So this is mesiobuccal cusp, which is largest one, then this is distobuccal cusp, slightly smaller, and this is distal cusp, which is present on the distalmost side and which is the smallest one among these 3. So we have carved 3 cusps over here. Similarly, on the lingual side, by carving 1 developmental groove, you carve 2 cusps. This is mesiolingual cusp and this is distolingual cusp. So total 5 cusps we have carved, and the mesial and distal profile is converging lingually. So you can see buccal cusp wider and lingual cusp are narrower. So how to identify this side? By seeing the presence of distal cusp, which is on the distal most side. So this is the one of the important side identification. So the crown is wider mesiodistally and mesial and distal profile is converging lingually. So this is the overall crown of this permanent mandibular first molar. Now we will carve this. You have carved mesial pit, distal pit, and central pit, and there is a groove. So the groove pattern will be Y shape. Why Y shape? Because 2 developmental grooves are coming from this side and 1 developmental groove from the lingual side. So 2 developmental groove from the buccal and 1 developmental groove from the lingual, it makes the Y groove pattern. Okay, so total 5 cusps, and this Y groove pattern makes 5 cusps, 3 on buccal side, 2 on lingual side. Now, as you can see from the proximal surface, from the proximal view, you can see the crown appears to be tilted lingually. Why? Appears to be tilted lingually because of this height of contour, which is more prominent at the cervical third area, and from the middle to the occlusal, it is gradually converging. Here also you can see the crown is lingually, it is narrower. So the crown is appears to be tilted lingually. Always remember, you have to make from premolar to molars all crown of teeth mandibular tilted lingually. Now we will carve root. The root length is shorter, as I already marked the root length over here. And as there are 2 roots, the one root is one is mesial and one is distal. There are 2 roots. It is different from premolar. In premolar, 2 cusps, 1 buccal and 1 lingual, and 1 buccal root and 1 lingual root. But in permanent mandibular first molar, the crown is wider mesiodistally, and there are 2 roots which is one is mesial root and one is distal root. So you have to make now buccal and lingual surface slightly narrower than mesiodistally, because root is wider, you have to make 2 roots. So you have to make mesiodistally wider and buccally lingually slightly narrower. So you can just remove wax gradually from the buccal and lingual side, and then you can carve root. So this is the way gradually you have to remove the wax. Don't just directly try to remove wax. Gradually you have to remove so that you can maintain the shape of tooth. Now this is the buccal side. I already removed wax from, and now this is the lingual side. After removing this wax, you have to for carving two roots, you have to, on the buccal side, you have to mark one developmental groove on buccal side. So this is the developmental groove I have marked, that is called linear depression on the buccal side. This is one marking on the buccal side. Similarly, same marking I will do on lingual side, exactly in the center and cervically, because the bifurcation area where the root is divided is at the cervical third area. Now you can see this groove I will make is more deeper, and I will try to make it more deeper so that I can divide the root into two equal parts. So you have to make this groove more deeper and deeper gradually from both the side, from mesial and distal side. After dividing this, making this groove more deeper and deeper so that your carver should go through and through. And now you can make this area wider, and the moment you make this wider, you will get two well separated roots. So from overall dimensions, now you can, from all over side, you can carve like this and make this one root separate one root, and by carving this portion separately on distal side, you can carve this distal root. So this way you have to make two well separated roots. So this is crown, which is wider mesiodistally. These are two roots, one is mesial and one is distal, well separated roots, and the apex of roots are always tilted distally, remember. So always see at the apical third area, to make the apex distally tilted, you have to carve slightly on the apical side, make a slight notch towards the distal portion, so that you can make the distal portion tilted, this apical portion tilted distally. So this way you have to carve permanent mandibular first molar. And the last step is, after carving this, you have to make all surfaces smooth, remove all undercuts and or irregularities by applying much pressure with this gauze piece, and make all surfaces smooth. This is finishing, and then polishing with the gauze piece, with a cotton ball and soap. You have to make this smoother surface, just clean it and make all surfaces shine. The lustering effect you should get in your carving, and you can submit your carvings. Thank you.